morning. All right, just a couple of announcements today. First, just a reminder that next week is already the time that we're going to meet for the annual congregational meeting. That's scheduled next Sunday. That'll be right after worship service. We'll keep it as short and sweet as possible. And then just a reminder, there is not a service on Sunday, December 25th here at Zion. There's some other options, though, that we can give to you. And then lastly, this is not listed in the bulletin, but the Cherry Street Mission is already out of winter coats to give to folks. They've given them out to all of their guests already. So if you guys have any gently used items that you would feel comfortable donating, they're in need of both men and women, mainly sizes large, extra large, and 2XL, but any of them are going to be they're going to be grateful for. But if you guys are comfortable bringing those in next week, we'll make sure they get where they need to go. Other than that, though, everything else is listed in the bulletin, so let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Amen. People of God, a new thing is growing in our midst, a tender branch, a living sign. By water and the Spirit, you are all joined to this wonder. You have put on Christ, and your sins have been washed away. Rejoice in the way of the Lord. Amen. And may the peace of Christ be with you always.
Our first reading today is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 11, verses 1 through 10. Isaiah describes the coming of a future, ideal ruler, who will renew David's royal line, the st- stump of Jesse. Gifted by the Spirit of God, this ruler will reign with perfect justice. Enmity and danger will be restored to harmony and peaceful coexistence. And now the reading. A shoot shall come out from the stump of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see, or decide by what his ears hear. But with righteousness he shall judge the poor, and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. Righteousness shall be built around his waist, and faithfulness the belt around his loins. The wolf shall live with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the kid, the cat and the lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze, their young shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the ass, and the weaned child shall put its hand on the adder's den. They will not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountains, for the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. On that day, the root of Jesse shall stand as a signal to the people. The nations shall inquire of him, and his dwelling shall be glorious. The word of the Lord. Let us read responsibly from Psalm 72. Give the king your justice, O God, and your righteousness to the king's son. That the mountains may bring prosperity to the people, and the hills in righteousness. May he live as long as the sun and the moon endure, from one generation to another. In his time, may the righteous flourish, and let there be an abundance of peace, till the moon shall be no more. And blessed be your glorious name forever, and may all the earth be filled with your glory. Amen. Our second reading is from Romans chapter 15, verses 4 through 13. God's promise to include Gentiles within the circle of God's blessed people has been fulfilled in Jesus Christ. Christians live out their unity by welcoming and encouraging each other, just as Christ has welcomed them into God's family. And now the reading. Whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, so that by steadfastness and by the encouragement of the Scriptures we might have hope. May the God of steadfastness and encouragement grant you to live in harmony with one another, in accordance with Christ Jesus, so that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome one another, therefore, just as Christ has welcomed you, for the glory of God. For I tell you that Christ has become a servant of the circumcised on behalf of the truth of God, in order that he might confirm the promises given to the patriarchs, and in order that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy. As it is written, therefore I will confess you among the Gentiles, and sing praises to your name. And again he says, rejoice, O Gentiles, with his people, And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and let all the peoples praise him. And again, Isaiah says, the root of Jesse shall come, the one who rises to rule the Gentiles. In him the Gentiles shall hope. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in the living, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. The word of the Lord. Let's stand and prepare for the gospel.
Another reading. those days John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness of Judea, proclaiming, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." This is the one of whom the prophet Isaiah spoke when he said, "The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." Now John wore clothing of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. Then the people of Jerusalem and all Judea were going out to him, and all the region along the Jordan, and they were baptized by him in the river of Jordan, confessing their sins. But when he saw how many Pharisees and Sadducees coming for baptism, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruit worthy of repentance, and do not presume to say to yourselves, 'Oh, we have Abraham as our ancestor.' For I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children or to Abraham. Even now the axe is lying at the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance. But one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor and will gather his wheat into the granary, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise
be seated. And now we continue with the lighting of the Advent wreath. Let us pray. Praise to you, O God, who gives us courage to start again. You fasten righteousness around your waist and baptize with the Holy Spirit's fire. Bless us as we mirror your holy fire, your mighty fire in these simple flames. And teach us to mirror your justice in the paths that we prepare. We ask that peace abound until more hurt, till none hurt or destroy over all the earth. Amen. Saying, "Merry Christmas, Charlie Brown." since it's this time of season, I think we ought to bury past differences and try to be kind. Charlie Brown asks her, why does it just have to be this time of the season? Why can't it be all year round? Lucy looks at him and exclaims, what are you, some kind of fanatic? One more Peanuts bit of wisdom. Lucy has a score to settle with Charlie Brown. She chases him, shouting, I'll get you, Charlie Brown. I'll get you. I'll knock your block off. Charlie Brown, who has been running full speed, stops, turns around, and says, wait a minute. Hold everything. We can't carry on like this. We have no right to act this way. The world is filled with problems. People hurting other people. People not understanding other people. Now, if we as children can't solve what are relatively minor problems, how can we ever expect to? Whereupon Lucy interrupts Charlie Brown in mid-sentence, hitting with a left to the jaw and knocking him out. Says Lucy, I hit it. Hit him quick. He was beginning to make sense. Our theme on this second Sunday in Advent is peace. We heard Isaiah write, the wolf shall dwell with the lamb, and the leopard shall lie down with the kid, and the calf and the lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. Let's begin this morning by acknowledging the horror of war between nations, as well as between families and individuals. The Bible tells us, as soon as there were two young men on earth, two brothers, there was war and death. War has always been with us. The pages of the Old Testament are drenched with blood, as are the chronicles of nearly every other culture on the face of the earth. We have the idea that war is deadly and awful because humankind now has such terribly destructive weapons. But the truth of the matter is, war has always been deadly. And it's always been awful. During the six bloodiest battles of the Civil War, an average of more than 30,000 men were killed and wounded or wounded in each one of those battles. 30,000. Brother is still fighting brother. Blood is still being shed. One of the hottest spots on earth, ironically, is the land of Jesus' birth. The more things change, says the cynic, the more they stay the same. And another cynic remarked that peace is a moment when nations take time to reload. I know that we'd rather not even think about war and strife at Christmas time. But because it is the celebration of peace on earth, we need to acknowledge the tragedy and the horror of God's children fighting with each other. But of course, war and strife are not God's will for our world. That's really our second point today. A nervous citizen once asked a prominent scientist if it were possible for an atomic bomb to destroy the earth. Suppose it does, replied the scientist with a shrug. It isn't as if the earth were a major planet. Perhaps in cosmic terms, the earth is a tiny planet. But it is the planet to which God sent his Son. We are a God-visited planet, to use C.S. Lewis's words. He has paid the ultimate compliment of his presence. And why did he do it? Why did he do it? Because of his love for us. For God so loved the world that he gave his Son, the evangelist John tells us. Certainly, then, there is no greater blasphemy for us than to harm persons whom God loves and sent his Son into the world to save. God's intent from the beginning for us and for all of creation has been peace and harmony. The song the angels sang at Christ's birth was peace on earth, goodwill to men. Christmas serves as an eternal reminder that hatred and fighting were never, never ever God's plan for any of us. There was a famous incident amid the horrors of the First World War that some of you may be familiar with. It was on Christmas Eve in 1914. All was quiet on France's western front, from the English Channel to the Swiss Alps. The war was only 5 months old, and approximately 800,000 men had already been wounded or killed. But on that Christmas Eve, something happened. Something unique in man's bloody history. British soldiers raised Merry Christmas signs above their trenches. And the hated Germans responded in kind. And pretty soon, Christmas carols were heard from German and British trenches alike. And Christmas Day of that year found unarmed soldiers from both sides beating the enemy in the middle of no man's land for song and conversation. Exchanging small gifts, they passed Christmas Day peacefully. unusual outbreak of peace occurred for miles along the battlefront. At one spot, the British played soccer with the Germans, and by the way, the Germans won 3-2. In some places, the spontaneous truth continued the next day as neither side was willing to fire the first shot. And finally, fighting resumed when fresh troops arrived, and the high command of both armies ordered that further informal understandings with the enemy would be punishable by treason, for treason. Christmas, small pocket of sanity in an insane world. War is horrible. It never, ever was part of God's plan for humanity. But one last thought for this Christmas season, that is that you and I, are called to be peacemakers. In 2 Corinthians, Paul tells us that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself and giving us a ministry of reconciliation. Remember what Jesus said on the Sermon on the Mount? Blessed are the merciful, the meek, the peacemakers. They are the children of God. And friends, that's still our task. The sign that we recognize the love of God for us shown in Christ is that we love each other, that we love each other and we live that love. Sometimes we encounter that call to love in the most unlikely places. Those of you who are computer buffs, I think, would appreciate something that appeared in the comic strip Shoo. In the comic strip, Santa is in front of his computer typing the following sentiments. Santa on the computer. 'Twas the morning of Christmas, and all through his house not a creature was stirring except Santa's mouse. For there on his screen, the old fat man designed the ultimate gift for a tattered humankind. He squirmed and he puzzled all through the night. He polished the concept to get it just right. The formula worked. The old guy was wired. At last, peace on earth. And then a message comes across the screen. Step one, some assembly required. Peace will never come easily, friends. For the motivation for war and fighting seems to be etched deeply on humanity's soul. But it can happen. It can happen if we acknowledge that all the world's people have a right to be here. All the world's people. God's help, the world can yet be saved from destruction. I've loved watching the bell choir practice. I stand in awe watching them count, and I don't know how you do it. But it reminded me about a legend of a big tower full of bells. Big tower full of bells. And there are 12 of them, 12 bells. And each of them thought that he must be more important than the rest. I know that doesn't happen here, but in the legend. And so they had an argument on the subject. Bell number one said, "Well, I'm number one. Of course I'm the most important. I ring first. There can be no doubt of that." Number two interrupted. "No, no, no. One is nothing without two." Number three chipped in rather angrily and said, "If you boys knew any theology, you would know that, of course, three is the number that counts." Before he had finished, number four said, "With four bells, you've got a perfect square. I must be the most important." And then five said, "Well, I'm one more than four. So anything that four claims, I can claim one extra." And six, of course, had a great deal to say for himself, as did number seven and number eight and number nine. By the time 10, 11, and 12 spoke up, the discussion had gotten so heated that the language used by numbers 10, 11, and 12 could not easily bear repetition. But they had not gotten the last word, because there was another character present. The spirit of the tower. And the spirit of the tower at last spoke and said, "My children, stop. Be silent. You're all talking a great deal of nonsense. Because the real point is that none of you is important all by yourself. We are only here to be used by God and for God's glory. And it's only when we work all together that we do any good to God or to other people. So stop talking and ring all together and strike all together. Midnight to the glory of God. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Let us pray. God of abundance, we bring before you the precious fruits of your creation, and with them our very lives. Teach us patience and hope as we care for all those in need until the coming of your Son, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The service continues with the Nicene Creed as printed on page 12 of your bulletin. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. As we prepare for the fullness of Christ's presence, let us pray to the world that yearns for new hope. God, you renew the church in every age. We give thanks for hymn writers and theologians, inspired teachers, writers, and musicians to delight and instruct your people. God, in your mercy, you give us a vision of creation in harmony, when hurting and destruction will be no more. Teach us to be stewards of the earth and companions to its creatures. Restore to balance and wholeness what human greed has harmed. God, in your mercy, you defend the cause of all who are poor and oppressed. Raise up leaders who will govern with equity and serve the common good. Guide judges, lawmakers, and public officials to protect the rights of those who cannot advocate for themselves. God, in your mercy, comfort with the grace of your Holy Spirit for all who are in sorrow or need, sickness or adversity. Remember those who suffer persecution for the faith. Have mercy on those to whom death draws near. Bring consolation to those in sorrow or mourning, and to all grant a measure of your love, taking them into your tender care. God, in your mercy, you urge your people to welcome one another as you have welcomed us. Nurture ministries of hospitality and care in this and every congregation. We pray for people who are homebound, hospitalized, or separated from loved ones. God, in your mercy, you embrace all who have died trusting in your promises, and we give thanks for their faithful witness. Sustain us in hope until we are united with them in the joy of your eternal presence. God, in your mercy, God of our longing, you know our deepest needs. By your Spirit, gather our prayers and join them with the prayers for all your children. In Jesus' name we pray.
The Lord be with you.
Also
lift up your hearts.
Lord.
Let us give thanks. to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You comforted your people with the promise of the Redeemer, through whom you will also make all things new in the day when he comes to judge the world in righteousness. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. body of our Lord Jesus Christ and his precious blood, strengthen and preserve you unto eternal life. Let us pray. God, for whom we wait, in this meal you give us a foretaste of that day when the hungry will be fed with good things. Send us forth to make known your deeds and to proclaim the greatness of your name. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God blesses us and sends us forth in mission. May God, the eternal Word, who dwells with us in Jesus and who holds us in grace of the Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen.
Peace.